I'll take this opportunity to remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 1A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of Stage 3. The period of voting for each division will be up to 1 minute, and members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press their request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. Group 1 is public admittance to licensing board meetings. I call Amendment 1 in the name of Graeme Simpson in a group of its own. I call Graeme Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking you for accepting this amendment? It's the same amendment that I spoke to yesterday, when it was in a group of two amendments, essentially dealing with the same thing. It's not my practice to bring back amendments that have already been debated, but I think we ended up yesterday in a pretty strange situation. My amendment deals with licensing boards. The other amendment yesterday from Alex Cole-Hamilton dealt with councils, and they both sought to do essentially the same thing, and that was to expire the provision which allowed both groups, both bodies, to bar members of the public from their meetings. And my argument was then, and it is now, that by the time we get to September, licensing boards and councils should be allowing members of the public into their meetings. There is simply no justification for continuing not to do so. But we ended up in a situation where the amendment which dealt with councils was accepted, and the amendment in my name which dealt with licensing boards was not accepted. And that to me was a completely illogical situation. And I went home rather perplexed by that, but I did think that the Deputy First Minister would realise the inconsistency of that situation. So I thought it was probably worth resubmitting the amendment. I thought he would realise we're in a pretty daft situation. He would reflect on that. And I'm hoping he has, because he's normally a reasonable man. So I look forward to hearing his comments. And I move the amendment.
Thank you. I call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to briefly return the favour that Graeme Simpson did me yesterday, I support this amendment for the same reasons I moved my own amendment, number 13, in respect of the public scrutiny. It really matters, particularly as it will come just months before a local authority election. People want to know how decisions are made, particularly around things that are important to them. So happy to support Graeme Simpson's amendment again.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I find myself in an absolutely terrible position this afternoon, that I fear that Graeme Simpson is able to interpret my mind, which is a truly awful situation to think that I might find myself in, because I did go home last night and reflect on the comments that Mr. Simpson made in his closing remarks in yesterday's debate, and believed that, not for the first time, I have to say, but not on all occasions, that Mr. Simpson had a reasonable point to advance in his closing remarks. So I hope those on the selection panel in the Conservative Party now notice that that's his career chances destroyed after that commendation from me. But I do think there is a fair and reasonable point that Mr. Simpson makes. So the government will support the amendment that Mr. Simpson has brought forward today. However, there is one issue that I do need to put on the record about the composition of the amendment, which does raise a bit of trickiness, if I'm allowed to put that onto the parliamentary record. In licensing legislation, Presiding Officer, there is a distinction between a meeting of a licensing board and a hearing of a licensing board. The amendment would require meetings of licensing boards to be held in public. Further analysis suggests that the acceptance of the amendment will still leave some discretion with licensing boards. Boards would continue to have discretion to determine that a hearing cannot be held in person for a reason relating to coronavirus. In such case, the board must offer alternate means for the participants to be heard remotely. That would mean that boards could continue to conduct hearings via remote means rather than person if there was a justifiable reason for doing so. But a licensing board would not do that lightly, nor should it. But if a hearing, which is the forum within which certain decisions under licensing legislation is made, needs to be conducted in this manner and done separately from a licensing board meeting due to coronavirus, then those arrangements will take their course. What this amendment would do is ensure meetings of licensing boards would be held in public. So, having listened carefully to the points that Mr Simpson has made, the Scottish Government is content to support Amendment 1 in light of the analysis I've placed on the record.
Thank you. I call Graeme Simpson to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 1.
Well, I'll certainly press it, and I can assure the Deputy First Minister that my career chances were over some time ago. colleagues will no doubt testify to that. And I'm not a mind reader, but I was just I was trying to delve into his mind from afar, and it looks like I've got it right. So I welcome his comments and once again move the amendment.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and we move on to Group 2, Care Homes. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendment 3. The Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 2 and speak to both amendments in the group.
President Officer, yesterday Jackie Bailey withdrew her amendment, which would have had the effect of extending the reporting provisions in relation to care homes beyond the 30th of September 2021 for the further temporary period of time. I listened to the views of members and made a commitment to reflect on how best to provide assurances for Parliament about this important matter. These issues were also raised by Gillian Mackay in the debate. I would like to suggest that we have brought forward a proposal that hopefully can be supported across the Chamber. Together, these amendments remove the provision in the Bill which seeks to expire Part 9 of Schedule 1 to the Coronavirus Scotland No. 2 Act 2020 and provides a deliverable solution which will have the effect of suspending, at the end of the 30th September, the temporary reporting duties placed on care homes and the Care Inspectorate. In making these amendments, we can safeguard the ability of the Care Inspectorate to discharge their statutory duties without hindering or diverting resources from wider scrutiny activity, including support to those care home services that fall short of the expected quality of care, and ease the burden of weekly reporting on care home staff. By suspending but not expiring these provisions, we are also able to provide reassurance that if there is a significant rise in COVID-19 cases in the future and subsequently an adverse impact on care homes, that ministers retain the power under Section 8 of the Coronavirus Scotland No. 2 Act 2020 to bring forward regulations to revive the original provisions at Part 9 of Schedule 1 of the No. 2 Act if there was clear evidence that this was necessary. I hope that these amendments, which the Care Inspectorate have been consulted on and assure me are practicable, reassures members that a flexible and deliverable process can be put in place, which not only supports the business of the Care Inspectorate and eases the burden on care homes, but provides assurance to the public and to Parliament of the mechanism to revive fortnightly reports on inspections and weekly deaths in care home reports if they are needed again at any stage during the pandemic, during the lifetime of the legislation, which I hope Parliament will endorse this afternoon. So with those comments, Presiding Officer, I hope Parliament is assured that we have tried to construct the proposition that addresses the issues that were raised yesterday by Gillian Mackay and Jackie Bailey, and accordingly I would move Amendment 2 in my name.
Thank you. I call Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, I'm content to support a suspension of this duty on the Care Inspectorate, but I am reassured if there is another wave of coronavirus that the Cabinet Secretary will move quickly to reinstate monitoring of care homes across Scotland. And on that basis, I will support Amendments 2 and 3.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, to wind up.
I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey for her support for these provisions. I think what we've successfully managed to do is to put in place an approach which allows the Care Inspectorate to focus on the essential work of assurance about the quality of the care home environment, but then retains the ability for us to exercise a power of oversight should that be required at a further stage in the pandemic. And I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey for her support for these provisions, and I would invite Parliament to support them.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 2. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We move on to Group 3, Notice to Parliament. I call Amendment 4 in the name of Jackie Bailey, in a group on its own. Jackie Bailey, to move and speak to Amendment 4.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish to move and speak to Amendment 4 in my name. Following yesterday's Stage 2 debate, I had discussions with the Scottish Government late into the night and in the early hours of this morning. I should, of course, point out it wasn't just about this amendment. This was agreed quite quickly, and I'm pleased to say that the amendment before the Chamber today is agreed by both parties. In essence, I want to ensure that there is the best opportunity possible for parliamentary scrutiny. I think the government benefits from that scrutiny and challenge, and we as parliamentarians have a duty to the people we represent to understand their concerns and reflect their views in this chamber. This amendment helps to ensure that this happens in the future. Bringing a statement to Parliament at least 24 hours before making changes to COVID-19 measures gives the government the right amount of flexibility and speed to respond to emerging situations, and the Parliament the ability to actually scrutinise it. My original amendment had a timescale of 14 days, which I acknowledged yesterday was far too long in an emergency. So on the basis that we have agreement, I am pleased to have worked with the government on this, and I would hope and urge the Chamber to support the amendment.
I call Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll make a very brief contribution. Yesterday, I was very happy to support Jackie Bailey's amendments, looking for 14 days advance notice, on the principle, really, that as much parliamentary scrutiny as possible should be encouraged. I recognise she did not progress these and has taken this back with a much more modest period of 24 hours. I hope she has not sold herself short in her negotiations with the Deputy First Minister. I was not able to secure a longer period. However, it is an improvement in what is in the bill, and on that basis, we will support this amendment.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased that we've reached agreement on this important provision. I think the point of principle that Jackie Bailey has advanced here is the importance of parliamentary notice. The government does not in any way dispute that. The question becomes then about the practicality. I'm delighted that I was able to negotiate Jackie Bailey down from 14 days to 24 hours. I think that's a triumph for my persistence over Jackie Bailey's unreasonableness. But we've got to a happy outcome at the conclusion of this process. So I think the amendment that is advanced by Jackie Bailey, the government is happy to support.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey, to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 4.
I wasn't intending to say anything in closing, but I can't resist the temptation. For the record, I think the Chamber should know that I never once spoke to the Deputy First Minister last night. Other people did it for him.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed and move on to Group 4, Reporting to Parliament. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 5A, 5B, 6, 7, 11, 12, 13 and 14. The Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 5 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Presiding Officer, this group of amendments deals with the issue of reporting, which we discussed at some length yesterday. I want to make clear at the outset that the Government recognises that when Parliament grants extraordinary measures of the type contained in the Scottish COVID Act, it is essential that there is transparency and openness about how those measures are being used and whether they remain necessary and appropriate. The first Scottish COVID Act put in place a robust reporting regime to deliver that transparency and continual review, and the Government recently published its seventh bi-monthly report. Those bi-monthly reports will continue to be published for as long as the measures in the Scottish COVID Act are in use, and I can offer my assurance to Parliament that we will aim to make those reports as helpful as we can to Parliament and to other observers. In considering the reporting amendments, which were lodged yesterday at Stage 2, my principal concern has always been how they fit around that existing reporting structure that has worked well up until now. My aim is to provide the enhanced transparency which the Parliament is seeking, whilst avoiding unnecessary duplication and ensuring that reporting requirements are proportionate and workable. The result of that consideration is the amendments which the Government has lodged today. I am keen that we have a very clear reporting structure agreed today and that we do not end up with a series of requirements which duplicate or conflict with each other, which would be the case, I believe, if a number of the amendments in this group were passed. I believe the Government's amendments can deliver on the creation of a clear reporting structure and will avoid any confusion in the reporting structure for Parliament, Government and, of course, stakeholders and the public. Amendment 5 in my name deals with yesterday's amendments, which sought one-off reports on specific topics. I have consolidated the intentions of yesterday's Stage 2 Amendments 25 to 30 into a single omnibus amendment. This will cover the information which Parliament sought on wedding and civil partnership ceremonies, support to help business, social security support to carers, support to persons who are self-isolating, social care services and fiscal fines. I know there are some specific issues which members would like to see addressed in these amendments. Paul Sweeney has expressed an interest in reports covering conditions for trade union recognition in large firms. Polly McNeill has a particular interest in live music at weddings. I am minded to accept Polly McNeill's Amendment 5A, which would add live music and live music venues to Amendment 5, on the basis that it fits with the general reporting structure that we are aiming to create. I am not minded to accept Polly McNeill's Amendment 5B, which I believe is already covered by Amendment 5A and introduces a level of detail that is not proportionate and consistent with the general reporting structure that has been proposed. Having accepted Polly McNeill's Amendment 5A, I would urge her not to press Amendment 7, which I do not consider to be necessary. For the same reasons, I am not minded to accept Paul Sweeney's Amendment 11 and Pam Duncan Glancy's Amendments 12 to 14. These amendments take the reporting structure to a level of detail which I consider to be beyond the structure and the design of the legislation that we have in place. For Amendment 12, I understand Pam Duncan Glancy is concerned that this amendment did not pick up the reporting requirement in relation to the Scottish Child Payment. This is because it is not relevant to the expiry of the Social Security provisions in the Scottish COVID Acts. I share the same ambitions as the member on addressing poverty for low-income families, and she will know that one of our six priority family groups is those with a disabled adult or child. We have reached over 70,000 families with the Scottish Child Payment and intend to reach many more when it is rolled out to under-16s by the end of next year. In the meantime, we are introducing bridging payments to reach all families in receipt of free school meals. We are making tackling child poverty a national mission, has been set out in this Parliament and reiterated by the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice just yesterday. What I've tried to do with my amendment is to create a general reporting structure which is flexible and which works within the scope of this bill. I believe that this is the best approach to take, but I'm happy to undertake to consider how the points raised by members might be addressed in the report which the Government will produce, and I would be happy to discuss that further with members if they would find that helpful. My Amendment 6 addresses the additional information which Parliament sought on evictions from dwelling houses. This reporting requirement will be embedded within the existing bi-monthly reporting requirement which the Government discharges. I also want to mention Polly McNeill's Amendment 4 from Stage 2. I undertook that the Government would write to Polly McNeill to provide her with the information which she sought on the welfare of prisoners, and I can confirm that this letter is being prepared. Presiding Officer, I hope that the amendments which the Government has lodged today on reporting will address the principal concerns of Parliament which we discussed yesterday at Stage 2, and I move Amendment 5 and would urge others not to press their amendments.
Thank you. I call Pauline McNeill to move Amendment 5A and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I speak to Amendments 5A, 5B and 7 in my name. 5A, which is an amendment which includes live music and live music venues, as the Cabinet Secretary spoke to, and 5B, but the permissibility of live music indoors and outdoor venues and the impact of limitations on indoor and household gatherings. And Amendment 7, which is a duty to report on the effect of an act of live music. I laid the three amendments in order to approach it in different ways so that the Government could consider what they might be prepared to accept. So I'm going to go on to say that I welcome what John Swinney said, a few more things I would like to see. I can't really give up on this battle for clarity on behalf of huge numbers of people. I could have said that I brought these amendments totally for the amusement of John Swinney, when I wasn't meaning anyone particular yesterday when we discussed the question of cringe dancing at weddings, as quoted by my constituent Brian Reardon, who I'd like to wish well for his wedding on the 31st of July. Today, I could be wrong, but I did think the First Minister, when she addressed the question of talking to the wedding sector, that there might be some more scope. If not, I would like to plead with the Government that I do think, in all honesty, there should be more relaxation on dancing restrictions for reasons I outlined yesterday. But I do want to sincerely thank the Cabinet Secretary for the exchange that we had yesterday, clarifying the easing of restrictions as it affects live music out with weddings as well, because I think every part of this helped people understand the decisions that the Government are making. Alex Hutchinson, who runs Cubic Festival in Sutherland, who had an event cancelled, said, "I think people forget that there are millions of people behind these closed industries, either directly or in the supply chain." And Transmit, which hopes to run this September, and many other promoters such as Regular Music, also highlight the Government's research shows that even minimal restrictions will have quite a damaging effect on the live music sector, which I know the Government are only too aware of. There are literally thousands of young bands and musicians who not only make a living from music, but suffer because they can't perform. It's what they love. And of course, unfortunately, as in many cases, brings mental health issues with it. And unlike other cities, we didn't run a pilot or a test event, which we could have done, including for the Download Festival. Music Pilot Festival was a pilot between the 4th and the 6th of June. However, I hope the Cabinet Secretary would appreciate that, that there are tens of thousands of musicians and performers, publicans, music venues, and the whole sector would be delighted if the Government continued to acknowledge that we require clarity and easing of restrictions and the mitigation talked about yesterday. Of course I will, yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Pauline McNeill for giving me. Can I give Pauline McNeill the assurance that the Government will engage actively with the sector, particularly between now and early August, so that we can work with the sector on the various elements of guidance that require to be put in place? Because as I mentioned yesterday in the debate, there will still be some requirements around questions on ventilation and hygiene and other questions, where it would be better if we, the Government, understands clearly the practical issues within the live music environment and the venues sector, so that we can formulate a position which is practical and helpful to the sector. It might not be everything that they would like, but at least we will be engaged in a practical discussion about those provisions.
Pauline McNeill.
I know that many people that I speak for will welcome that intervention, because they wouldn't like to think that the discussion would simply end because the Parliament ends today. and that these discussions will be ongoing, as Cabinet Secretary outlines, that the sector itself has a lot of ideas to offer the government, but they fully understand that there are still going to be issues of mitigation. I think everyone understands that we have to do this in a safe way, so that's very much appreciated. Just lastly, I said yesterday that Scotland didn't make any mention of the nighttime economy, which of course has live music at the centre of, whereas Northern Ireland, England and Wales did. So I was hoping that in the reporting processes that nighttime economy would not be missed out because of that interest. So I think in the interest, I would obviously have liked a bit more, but I think in the interest of working with the government and compromising, they will be happy not to move Amendment 5B and Amendment 7 in my name. Lastly, I just want to acknowledge what Cabinet Secretary said on Amendment 4, which I moved yesterday, which the Cabinet Secretary said that there will be a letter to me on the issue of welfare of prisoners, and I would just like to welcome that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Paul Sweeney to speak to Amendment 11 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to speak to Amendment 11 in my name. I have to say I'm disappointed in what the Government have presented at Stage 3 today, following the amendment in my name yesterday. I took their commitments in good faith, so to not even mention trade unions or bus operator reform on the face of the bill is simply not good enough. The way this legislation has been brought forward in the last week, before summer recess, has been extremely rushed, making scrutiny and the chance of effecting meaningful change near impossible. We have opportunities to harness the allocation of vast state support for the private sector as a means of achieving better social and economic outcomes. Yet, shamefully, it seems like the government is willing to miss out on those opportunities. In the case of private bus companies across Scotland, they receive an average of £314 million every year in public subsidy. That's 45% of their annual revenues. And the Scottish Government has given private bus companies an additional £200 million of grants in the last year alone. That is an obscene amount of cash from the public sector in return for a disproportionately priced and inadequate service. My amendment meets with the established mission of this Parliament. Happy to take an intervention.
I have to rise to defend my constituency Borders Buses, who have done their utmost to deliver a service in these times and giving free transport to those working in the care and health service. So public sector good, but private sector not all bad. Please take that into account.
Paul Sweeney.
Well, if only it were always the case. I have to say, in Glasgow, that's not the experience. And certainly, we'd be able to level up, to coin a phrase, if we had proper franchising measures in place. I think it's fair to say, in response to that intervention, that my amendment meets with the established mission of this Parliament, both in terms of government policy and legislation already on the statute books. There are no grounds for ministers to reject it on this basis. In 2018, the then Transport Minister, Humza Yousaf, said that the government will not stand by as bus passenger numbers decline. But if that was the case, why has the amount of bus journeys in Scotland continued to decrease by 12% over the last 5 years, whilst bus passengers have experienced a 9% increase in fare prices over and above inflation between 2015 and 2019? Greater Manchester's new approach means that fares, timetables and routes will be set by the Regional Transport Authority instead of private companies. But private operators may still be able to continue running franchises, running those services under a franchising system. I've recognised that it's important not to make the perfect the enemy of the good and to benchmark against best practice regions like Greater Manchester. So in the spirit of maximising the chance for us to move forward in this area, I have adjusted my amendment from yesterday to simply ask for ministers to consult private bus companies and local authorities on the potential of regional franchising as a condition of future financial support from the state. Scotland has the powers to follow this example. We secured amendments in the 2019 Transport Act to do so. However, a Scottish Government FOI from the 2nd of June this year clarified that no discussion or communication had taken place between Transport Scotland and local authorities in relation to funding for franchising. Indeed, the Minister was reported as saying, "I can confirm no discussion or communication has taken place between Transport Scotland and local authorities in relation to funding for franchising, public ownership of bus service improvement partnerships." Instead of giving no-strings, grant-based funds to private bus providers and facilitating a bus service that is ever more overpriced and fragmented, The government have an opportunity in my amendment to use these massive allocations of public subsidies to drive forward what this parliament has already agreed in the 2019 Transport Act, to deliver a franchising system in every region of Scotland that will underpin a public bus service that is fit for purpose. My amendment allows us to take this basic step forward. Surely there is no reasonable basis to reject initiating consultation with local authorities, bus companies and regional transport authorities to prepare the ground on this very important issue. Especially with such vast sums of public money being pumped into private bus companies, we cannot continue to socialise losses and privatise profits. And on the point raised about trade unions, the First Minister herself said in her speech to the Scottish Trade Union Congress in 2019 that the Scottish Government recognises the value of everything the trade union movement does for Scotland. You are fundamental to the fairer Scotland that we all want to see. Increasing collective bargaining in Scotland is not just a trade union objective, it is a national objective. So if the Scottish Government holds the rights of workers and the role of trade unions in such high regard, surely supporting my amendment to consult with businesses in receipt of support from the state about increasing trade union recognition is a common sense step to take. The Welsh Labour Government has already taken this step. It is not unreasonable to ask the Scottish Government to do so too. Even the Pope has said that efforts to rebuild economies after COVID-19 must aim at a future with decent and dignified working conditions by giving workers the right to organise in trade unions. So in pain of excommunication, perhaps people might consider supporting it in the Chamber today. And certainly, my point in summation is really that instead of allocating funds on an ad hoc basis, we should consider how we can condition this support to achieve better social and economic outcomes, not just over the next 6 months under the pandemic, but in the long term. That is approaches we've taken before in the face of national crises. We've used it as an opportunity to underpin major reform. Happy to give way in my final points.
Jamie Green.
Thank you to the member. I listened carefully to yesterday's debate and this on the issue, and I know the member feels very strongly about trade unions, but is he seriously suggesting that the government should not support businesses or individuals who are not affiliated to trade unions? Because that's an utterly bonkers suggestion.
Paul Sweeney.
No, though I have to say that any business of a large size, over 250 employees, I think it's reasonable to expect that they ought to permit trade union organisation if the workers so desire. Though I wouldn't necessarily make it conditional at this point, because as I've indicated in my revised amendment, I've not applied conditionality in my proposal. I've merely asked that the government consult with the relevant businesses in receipt of support to encourage them in that discussion to accept trade union organisation, which I think is a very reasonable step forward. And I feel that that adjustment from yesterday perhaps might meet with greater support within the chamber today. I just want to say that I feel all too often we hear empty words from the government on the advancement of public transport, on trade union rights, but when it comes to the crunch, they don't come up with the goods. So I'd like them to seek to support my amendment. I would certainly invite support from across the House, and for once I would hope that the government put those empty sentiments into action.
Thank you. I call Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 12 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, we were clear that had the scope of this bill been wider, we would have sought to do much more with it to ensure that protections given to people during the pandemic are available for a while longer, and sought to add further provisions needed to meet the challenges ahead. Presiding Officer, in my short time in this Parliament, I have been asked to input to two bills that have been presented as limited in scope and in the ability to amend. Whilst I understand the reasons for relative speed, I would like to put it on record that I find this to be a way of working that is not as supportive of collegiate lawmaking or of harnessing the potential of all of Scotland's people as I would hope. And I'm sure the Government and others will share that hope, that this is not the way forward when we return. Scottish Labour was very clear yesterday that while we have been able to amend this bill in the way we wished, we had intended to move a number of amendments at stage two that would have placed duties on the government to report to Parliament within a month of this bill receiving royal assent on the effect of expiry or otherwise of various current provisions, particularly as they relate to some of the people most impacted by the pandemic, for example, disabled people, people on low incomes and carers. My amendments focused on provisions in place to protect these groups and the need to assess whether further measures, including those we set out in the Chamber yesterday on adding a supplement to the Scottish TEL payment, making further double payments of the carer supplement and creating a self-isolation support grant. This Chamber will be aware that I did not move my amendments yesterday. I did not do so on the basis of the commitment offered by the Cabinet Secretary that the Government would bring forward a wide-scale reporting requirement that would bind them to report to the Parliament on the impact of the extension or expiry of provisions. So I don't expect that the Cabinet Secretary will be too surprised to hear me say that I was slightly disappointed when I saw the government amendments earlier today and the limited provisions it requires on reporting. I feel strongly that the amendment brought by the government today, Amendment 5, is not strong enough. It requires reporting on information and plans, but not on effect or impact. For this reason, I do not feel that Amendment 5 offers even the limited protections that we were able to seek in our original amendments for reporting yesterday. By specifically asking the government to consider the effect of both continuing or expiring such provisions, we sought to encourage not only an assessment of where we are now or where we are going, and thus what future measures we need, but also to encourage some reflection on where we have been. I understand concerns about the detail that this asks for that the Cabinet Secretary has just outlined, but it is the detail, Cabinet Secretary, that we need to get this right. And there are organisations across Scotland and people across Scotland who I'm sure will be pleased to help with you, to help you in that regard. In respect of my Amendment 12, I welcome the inclusion within Amendment 5 to require a report on the social security support available to carers to cope with the additional pressures of the pandemic and what further support it will consider. However, I feel strongly that it doesn't capture the depth of the report amendment in the amendment suggested and in the way I just described. It is important, as I said, to look at what support is available and what plans there are for the future, and to understand the effect of measures in place to allow future consideration of what we should do in the future. Amendment 5 also misses the crucial ask to report on support for families with a disabled person in them, and specifically whether a £5 supplement to the Scottish Child Payment is required to do this, and whether that is sufficient. The omission of this group of people from the report is disappointing, given the levels of child poverty this chamber heard of yesterday and the impact the pandemic has had on this group. I can see that this could be, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, outwith the reporting mechanisms of the bill, but that is largely because of the limited scope of the bill in the first place. All my amendment was trying to do was to ask for the government to consider whether it will do this in the context of COVID. I will therefore continue to press that amendment. I don't doubt that if there had been more time to engage with the government on this issue, that we could have resolved much of this through constructive engagement, which I'm sure the government would partake in, without bringing back the amendments. Unfortunately, instead, with time not on our sides, we will back Amendment 5, but press with Amendments 12 to try to ensure the depth of consideration is given. On Amendment 13, in the same vein as I've set out, again, Amendment 5 falls short. I will therefore be pressing this again today, and I will be moving Amendment 13. Lastly, Presiding Officer, the Chamber will also recognise Amendment 14, as I brought this yesterday and didn't press it. Unfortunately, I do not feel that the Amendment 5 goes far enough in setting out what it is we want to look at and assess. Amendment 14 is clear, and my name is clear, on where we feel monitoring assessment must take place, and I have set out in contributions throughout this week the importance of any report looking at the impact of reducing eligibility for social care packages, and in contributions today of the importance of looking back as well as forward. For that reason, Amendment 5 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary has, I'm afraid, also fallen short of where we would have liked it to be. Presiding Officer, please be assured that I bring the amendments back today not to keep us here longer than needed, but to draw attention to the serious issues, apply as much scrutiny as we can in the time we have, and encourage meaningful and impactful discussion and action from this chamber. I move the amendments in my name.
Thank you, and I call Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll just comment briefly on the amendments in this group. I welcome Amendments 5 and 6 put forward by the Deputy First Minister, which I think are some reasonable progress being made in relation to the points that have been made in the Chamber yesterday. We were happy yesterday to support the various amendments that came forward on improving reporting, and these amendments from the Government go some way towards recognising some of these concerns. However, I would share the concern that's been expressed by some members that they may not go far enough. In relation to the amendments from Pauline McNeill, I think she makes fair points about support for live music venues. I know this is an issue she has pursued assiduously in this chamber over many years, and if she pursues her amendments, we will support them. In relation to the amendments from Pam Duncan-Glancy, again, our view would be that these are reasonable in asking for reporting on issues such as social security support for carers and on social care, and if she presses them, it would be our intention to support them. We cannot, however, support Paul Sweeney's amendment number 11, and our concern with that is it brings in what are quite significant issues of policy, which in our view are not appropriate to bring forward in an emergency bill. There has been no opportunity to debate these issues, no opportunity to take any external consultation on the matters he raises. However worthy they might be, An emergency bill we are rushing through Parliament in the course of 3 days is not the vehicle to discuss these matters in any detail. And for that reason, I'm afraid we will not be supporting Mr Sweeney, but we will be supporting the other amendments in this group. Well, I'm sorry, I'm just finished, but I'm allowed to give way.
Paul Sweeney.
I was just going to appeal to his better nature and ask that surely those matters were settled in the 2019 Transport Act, therefore we're merely giving effect to what Parliament has already debated in great detail.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, I just don't believe an emergency bill is the correct opportunity to discuss these matters that many other members have not had the opportunity to engage with in any detail. I believe my colleague Graeme Simpson may have more to say on this in a moment. Thank you.
Thank you. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I want to touch upon Mr Sweeney's amendment. And I think Mr Sweeney actually will have an unintended consequence if his amendment actually were to pass. And that's there are 300 people in my constituency who are now working. If, going by Mr Sweeney's amendment, even if the must consult part of his amendment were to, if this amendment were to pass, and if this, as Mr Sweeney also indicated, it wouldn't make it a condition, but also he suggests a better social and economic impact going forward. I quote him from earlier on. This particular amendment, if this were to pass, and if a similar situation that happened in my constituency in 2018 were to happen at some point going forward, then the 300 employees who are now working at Diodes in Greenock, which they are now working thanks to the cross-party efforts and also government and also local authority with a task force to actually save the jobs. Texas Instruments were closing. It was a profitable business, but they were closing, and the Scottish Government and Inverclyde Council and other public sector organisations worked tremendously hard to get a solution. And in February 2019, those jobs were saved. Now, Mr Sweeney, I am not averse to the suggestion regarding trade union representation. Genuinely not averse to that at all. However, even if the part of must consult where to go forward, then I fear that if a similar situation were to happen, whether it's in my constituency or anywhere else in Scotland, then potentially those jobs would be lost in the future. So I would urge colleagues to reject that amendment when we get to the vote. Thank you.
I call Graeme Simpson.
Well, I'd better say something, seeing as Murdo Fraser has teed me up. Yeah, well, it's too late for that. I do want to comment on Amendment 11 in the name of Paul Sweeney. I think Mr Sweeney has got this completely wrong. This is, it's classed as emergency legislation. We don't see it as that, but that's the way we're dealing with it. Mr Sweeney seemed to want to introduce a wider transport debate. And of course, he rightly points to the Transport Act and the provisions in that, some of which have not been enacted yet. The time to deal with that is when these provisions come in and Parliament can debate them at that point. Now is not the time. I welcome the colossal sums that have been put into the bus industry and the rail services as well to keep public transport moving. That has been vital. What we cannot have is a situation as we move on that we make it a condition of support. Those are the words in Mr Sweeney's amendment, that private bus companies, which he appears to hate, and local authorities would only receive support if they're going to move down a regional franchising route. Emergency support, I should point out to Mr Sweeney. So I think he's got this completely wrong, and we'll oppose it.
I call Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I didn't intend to actually take my people off and say that and then take part in the debate. I can't support Mr Sweeney's amendment. And I appreciate that it's been ruled as competent, but I understood the bill doesn't have a purpose, that the bill and the policy memorandum is to update a range of existing legislative measures supporting various aspects of the ongoing response to the public health emergency caused by the COVID pandemic, amending two bills. This is an amending bill to existing legislation. It's not to introduce new provisions. So there's a good debate to be had, but I can't see how your amendment fits into this bill in any shape or form. So, for me, it's a process matter. Well, I think I'm intervening. What am I doing? Oh, yes, you can. I'm speaking. I forgot what I was doing. I thought I was intervening on you, but I'm not anymore. Yes, certainly.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank the member for giving me. Surely the member recognises that I might not have been afforded the opportunity to shape those prior instruments of legislation, and that it's not the important cornerstone of our constitution is that a previous parliament cannot bind another. And that surely if we are looking to deliver social outcomes that are positive in this country, which this parliament has already agreed are favourable, then we should be looking at measures to drive that forward. And indeed, if we are looking at those future opportunities, surely, if we're not going to endorse them now, then it's a tacit acceptance that the current damaging status quo is acceptable.
Christine Graham.
You should really listen to me, Mr. Sweeney. I said this is an amending bill to existing parts of legislation, not introducing something new. End of the debate.
Not quite the end of the debate. I call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up on Amendment 5.
Officer, let me become the voice of calm in this debate. But in some of this is a fascinating debate, and with some interesting contributions which I will reflect on. First of all, Polly McNeill's contribution. I think members have quite rightly and properly commended Polly McNeill for the assiduous way in which she has pursued the interests of the perspectives of the live music sector, and she raises very important issues. I think in the course of this passage of this legislation, she and I have had the opportunity to have exchanges which are on the record, which I hope provide reassurance to those that I know she listens to carefully and speaks on their behalf, and I will make sure that we follow through on the dialogue that I have committed to in the discussions today. What I've tried to do in the, and this is where I draw on the distinguished contribution of one of our long-serving members, Christine Graham, in her legislative assessment, is to formulate proposals that are consistent with the framework of the bill. And I know that not everybody agrees with the judgments that I have made about the framework of the bill. I know the Labour Party would like me to go further. I know the Conservative Party believes that I've gone far too far already, but that didn't seem to stop Mr Simpson wanting me to go further in the debate earlier on. So I simply say that I'm trying to reach some forms of agreement in this debate. But what we've tried to do is to focus on legislation that Parliament has already passed and to update it for the current circumstances that we face on COVID. We have not tried to use this debate, this bill, although members of Parliament clearly would have liked us to have done that, to stretch much further. There are plenty of opportunities to stretch much further in terms of COVID recovery, in terms of the policy response to tackle fundamental inequalities, in terms of the steps that we need to take to support business. That will all be part of the COVID recovery agenda that Parliament the government brings forward and that Parliament considers. But this is quite a tight bill, updating existing legislation that Parliament has already passed. So for those reasons, I've tried to extend the reporting requirements as broadly as I think it is reasonable to do so within the confines of this legislation, which is what makes it impossible for me to support the amendments from Pam Duncan-Glancy, because I believe they go much further than the scope of the bill, and they run, particularly the amendments as drafted, run the risk of putting confusion into statute, because the government has, you know, I'm assuming from the discussions and the tenor of the debate today, Amendment 5 will pass. That will provide a scope for reporting, and then there will be additional provisions that will broaden that scope. And I think that creates the sources of confusion. Of course, yes.
Pauline McNeill.
So it's on this question of broadening the scope, so I won't rehash all the arguments about how narrow the bill is. Sorry to return to the issue of dancing, but
a lot of people in the wedding sector are saying for the sake of 9 days, maybe, did I hear the First Minister correctly when she said she's engaged with the sector? For the sake of 9 days, and in all seriousness, that means that couples, if you relax those restrictions now, then that means all these couples from literally the 31st of July onwards could get the advantage of that. My question is this. Can you ask Jason Leach or Gregor Smith, what is the clinical reason? What is the clinical reason that people cannot have dancing at their weddings? Because I can't see it.
Cabinet Secretary.
As luck would have it, I was involved in a conversation this morning involving the two gentlemen that Pauline McNeill refers to, in which I was raising these very issues. And these issues are being considered as part of...
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary, can we have quiet at the rear of the chamber? Thank you.
Sounds almost as if there's some dancing going on in the back of the chamber, Presiding Officer, but who am I to interrupt the fun of my colleagues at the back? The issues that Pauline McNeill raises are being explored. The First Minister said that at First Minister's Question Time today, and we are trying to be as helpful as we possibly can do if there is any way in which we can exercise some degree of... Because, you know, the First Minister... well, Jackie Bailey was talking yesterday, I think, about the relaxation of requirements around some of the arrangements when people are in pubs for some of the football games that might go to penalties. And we've taken pragmatic action about that to avoid situations that could be disruptive. So we are able to take pragmatic action, and those issues are being actively explored. If I could then come to the, if I might call it, the controversial part of the debate, which is Mr Sweeney's contribution. And he raises absolutely legitimate issues of debate. They're completely legitimate issues, so I don't in any way dismiss them whatsoever. But I do think the amendment should not pass for a number of reasons. The first is that a number of the issues that Mr Sweeney raised are already provided for in existing statute. And going back to my argument about not causing confusion in statute, if there's already provision in the Transport Scotland Act 2019, then in a bill of this character, which has got a narrow scope, I don't see the necessity for us to expand that provision if it's already provided for. Secondly, I want to counter this view, and Mr Sweeney used these words, that funds had been allocated on an ad hoc basis to transportation companies. Funds have been allocated in a fashion to try to sustain public transport services in Scotland. If the government had not expended the money in the way that it had, we would not have public transport services available to us for the post-pandemic situation. It's as simple as that. So those have been emergency distributions of funds to try to sustain a sector who, through the impact of the pandemic, were unable to take in any fares because of the situation that they faced. Of course.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. He makes a fair point, which I accept. It's essential to maintain these services because they're critical to our communities across Scotland. My point about being ad hoc is simply that they aren't thinking strategically. It's a reactionary measure to maintain existing services as they are, however inadequate they might be. We've already seen other parts of the UK evolve that position, such as Greater Manchester, to see how we can develop franchising as the best practice model across public transport in the UK. This was merely a means of evolving our position in Scotland to use that support, that extensive state support, more efficiently in the interest of the public good.
I'm not close to all of the details about the Greater Manchester transport system, but I would hazard a guess that a lot of that work was done pre-COVID. And that's where there's a legitimate point that Mr Sweeney raises, which is addressed in the Transport Scotland 2019 Act, which is that these options can be pursued. My point would be the funding that was available during the pandemic has quite literally been survivability funding, upon which we would, if we had not dispersed it, we would not have public transport services able to be used today. So those are issues that I think Parliament can come back to and consider, and indeed they form part of the policy agenda of the government. And lastly, the government is entirely committed to the Fair Work agenda. Indeed, I was involved in an extensive discussion this morning with representatives of a broad cross-section of opinion in Scottish society, business people, third sector representatives, public sector representatives. And at the heart of that was a discussion around how we can use the Fair Work agenda to structure our recovery from COVID. So I assure Parliament of the Government's intention to be absolutely focused on using every instrument at our disposal to advance some of these arguments. So on the basis of those points, Presiding Officer, I would urge Parliament to support Amendment 5 in my name and Amendment 5A in the name of Polly McNeill, and I would encourage Parliament to resist all the other amendments in the group. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Pauline McNeill to wind up on Amendment 5A and to press or withdraw.
On the basis that the Government is supporting it, I will press Amendment 5A.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 5A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. I call Amendment 5B in the name of Pauline McNeill, already debated with Amendment 5. Pauline McNeill to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, to press or withdraw Amendment 5 as amended.
Yeah, I would press as amended, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 5 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 5. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 7 in the name of Pauline McNeill, already debated with Amendment 5. Pauline McNeill to move or not move?
Not moved.
We move on to Group 5, and I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 9, 10, 15, 16 and 17. The Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 8 and speak to all amendments in the group.
So this final group relates to minor and consequential amendments resulting from yesterday's Stage 2 discussions. As indicated yesterday when I was speaking in support of Jackie Bailey's Amendment 15, today's Amendments 8, 10, 15 and 17 are technical consequential amendments to tidy up the statute book. Currently, the Scottish Ministers are required by the Scottish Coronavirus Act to leave statements in Parliament alongside any regulations under those Acts being progressed under the Made Affirmative Procedure. However, the ability to progress regulations under the Made Affirmative Procedure rather than the Draft Affirmative Procedure is being expired on the 30th of September 2021. Therefore, Amendments 8, 10, 15 and 17 ensure that the requirement to lay accompanying statements is repealed at the same time. Similarly, Amendments 9 and 16 are technical amendments to tidy up the statute book as a consequence of Alec Cole Hamilton's Amendment 13 being agreed by Parliament yesterday at Stage 2. These ensure all provision in the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020 relating to local authorities being able to physically exclude the public from local authority meetings is repealed on the 30th of September 2021 when that measure is expired. I therefore ask members to support Amendments 8, 9, 10, 15, 16 and 17 in my name.
Thank you.
We'll just keep the question.
Yeah. Would you like to wind up, Cabinet Secretary?
I have nothing further to add.
In that case, the question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 8, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 8. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 11 in the name of Paul Sweeney, already debated with Amendment 5. Paul Sweeney, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed, therefore there will be a division, and as this is the first division of this stage, Parliament is suspended for 5 minutes. The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to, and members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment number 11 in the name of Paul Sweeney is yes 30, no 90. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 12 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 5. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed, and members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 12 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy is yes 59, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 13 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 5. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment number 13 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy is yes 59, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 14 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 5. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Presiding Officer, I'm nothing if not a trier. Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. Members should cast their votes now. I call Shirley Ann Somerville for a point of order.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My voting app froze, but I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Somerville. We'll be back with you in a moment. Thank you, Ms Somerville. We have recorded that. I have a point of order from Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I may have made a mistake, but I was sure I voted no, so it should be no.
Thank you. Your comment is on the record, Mr. Kidd, but I regret we cannot correct the vote at this point. The result of the vote on amendment number 14 in the name of Pam Duncan Clancy is yes 61, no 60. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore agreed. I call amendments 15, 16 and 17. Thank you. Thank you. I call amendments 15, 16 and 17, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated with Amendment 8. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move amendments 15 to 17 on block.
Moved on block, President.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 15 to 17? No member objects, and the question is that amendments 15 to 17 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and that ends consideration of amendments. As members will be aware at this point in proceedings, I'm required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in my view, any provision of the bill relates to a protected subject matter, that is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in my view, no provision of the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill relates to a protected subject matter. Therefore, the bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at Stage 3. And there will be a brief pause before we move on to the Stage 3 debate. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, colleagues, can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and around the Holyrood campus. I ask members to take care and observe the measures, including when exiting and entering the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. Can I also suggest that or advise that as we are running quite a bit ahead of schedule, I intend closing the debate an hour after we start, as opposed to the scheduled time. I'm sure that will meet with approval, widespread approval, except from the Deputy First Minister, by the looks of things. Anyway, I now would ask members who want to participate in the Stage 3 debate to press their request to speak buttons now or put an R in the chat function if they're joining us online. And I call on the Deputy First Minister to speak to and move the motion around 7 minutes. Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For the purposes of Rule 9.11 of the Standing Orders, I advise Parliament that Her Majesty, having been informed of the purport of the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill, has consented to place her prerogative and interests, insofar as they are affected by the Bill, at the disposal of Parliament for the purposes of the Bill. I am pleased, Presiding Officer, to present the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill to Parliament for debate at Stage 3, and I invite members to agree to pass the Bill. Presiding Officer, as we have been conducting our proceedings this afternoon and during the course of the last 40 minutes, the funeral has been taking place in Arbroath of my dear friend and colleague Andrew Welsh, who was the Member of the Scottish Parliament for Angus and my neighbouring Member of Parliament for the Angus East constituency when I was a Member of the House of Commons. Andrew and I have shared a political journey over the last 40 years that I've had the privilege to know him and experience his support, loyalty and commitment, and it is a matter of enormous personal regret to me that I am not able to be at his funeral this afternoon, although the First Minister is there and is addressing the funeral on our behalf. Andrew Welsh is, in my view, one of the finest individuals I have ever had the privilege to know in my life, a man of deep integrity, loyalty, faithfulness and commitment, who served the people that we both represented in the county of Angus with devotion for so many years. He was rightly accorded an honour that he cherished enormously, which was to be made a Freeman of Angus. And it was in recognition of the devoted service that he gave to the people of his beloved county. So I am grateful to have the opportunity, Presiding Officer, to place on the record my own tribute to one of the finest individuals I have ever met, and to extend my love and sympathy to Sheena and to Jane at this heartbreaking time for them both and their family. Presiding Officer, it is against the backdrop of ongoing uncertainty and continued necessary restrictions and changes to the way of working and living that we can see why this bill is vital to our continuing response to COVID-19. I'm grateful to the many members from across the Chamber who approached this bill in a constructive way to ensure necessary adjustments can remain in place beyond the 30th of September. The debate over the last couple of days has been characterised by a debate which the Conservatives, I think entirely reasonably, have argued was a debate that was taking place in an accelerated timescale, and the Labour Party, who have argued that this bill should have been more extensive and more expansive. But what I've tried to set out to Parliament is a genuine practical observation that I wanted to make sure that public authorities, businesses and others were clear of what will be expected of them at the 30th of September, when the current legislative framework would be due to elapse, and allow them to plan for the circumstances that will arise. I'll give way to Sarah Boyack.
Sarah Boyack.
Uh, Thank you, the Deputy First Minister, for taking an intervention. It's to ask a question about the impact of the legislation and the reporting framework on theatres and cultural venues, because the impact of the restrictions now is a critical issue for them, because they are planning ahead to Christmas performances and they have issues about how the restrictions will operate over the next few weeks. So is there potential of giving further clarity on the limits on the numbers of people that are able to access our theatres and cultural venues in the summer period and then after the end of September? Would that be possible to clarify, Deputy First Minister?
I would certainly hope that the announcements that were made on Tuesday by the First Minister, particularly around physical distancing, which is one of the principal factors that affects the issues of capacity around artistic venues, would have provided the necessary clarity for the theatre and cultural sector. And obviously, we are optimistic that the control of the pandemic will enable us to sustain the commitments that the First Minister made on Tuesday. Now, obviously, the culture ministers, Angus Robertson and Jenny Gilruth, will be engaging actively with the sector to make sure they have sufficient clarity, and I'm very happy to make sure that that remains the case.
My apologies for not clarifying. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's the issue about whether there's a limit on the cap on the number of people in venues in addition to the restrictions in terms of the 1 metre distancing. Thank you for letting me come in on that issue.
Deputy First Minister.
The issue about caps on particular venues, any detail on that is specified within the strategic framework on the contents of level one, level two currently in some parts of the country, level one and then level zero, and then obviously beyond level zero there are no caps because we are then without physical distancing. So I hope that provides the clarity that Sarah Boyack was looking for. The provisions of the legislation that I hope Parliament will pass shortly will ensure there is no gap between the Scottish Act's expiring and the new provisions taking effect, which would only add confusion to the confusion caused by coronavirus. I'm also grateful to members for their amendments to the bill. I think we've had a constructive process. The government has engaged substantively on these issues to try to ensure that we responded positively to the suggestions that were made. I want to make clear at the outset that the government recognises that when Parliament grants extraordinary measures of the type contained in the Scottish COVID Act, it is essential that there is transparency about how those measures are being used and whether they remain necessary and appropriate. I welcome members' contributions to strengthen further the extensive system of reporting that is already in place. The first Scottish COVID Act put in place a robust reporting regime to deliver that transparency and continual review, and the Government recently published the seventh bi-monthly report and published the next report in August. Those bi-monthly reports will continue to be published, now covering reporting on measures in respect of tenants' rights, for as long as the measures in the Scottish COVID Act are in use, and I can offer my assurance to Parliament that we will aim to make those reports as helpful as we can to Parliament and other observers. The amendments agreed today will also ensure that there is a single omnibus one-off report which will cover the information which Parliament sought on wedding and civil partnership ceremonies, support to help business, fiscal fines, live music, social security support to carers and social care services. I recognise that members would have liked to have gone further in introducing new measures beyond the limited scope of the bill, but the limited scope was entirely necessary to assist with parliamentary scrutiny within the time that is available. Having the bill agreed today by the Parliament allows appropriate time for the bill to receive royal assent early in August, and my officials will use that time to make sure all necessary guidance is updated and made available to stakeholders and the public more widely, so that it is clear to all which provisions Parliament has decided should remain available beyond the end of September and which ones will be expiring at that time and what that means for those who are impacted. I believe this bill makes an important contribution to our national response against the pandemic. I'm very grateful for Parliament's swift action in addressing this. And accordingly, Presiding Officer, I move that the Parliament agrees that the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill be passed into law.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. And can I echo your comments in relation to Andrew Welsh, who is the convener of the first committee I sat on? He certainly commanded respect across the chamber for very good reason. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak for around 6 minutes, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I just start by associating myself with the comments you've just made and with the comments from the Deputy First Minister about Andrew Welsh. Andrew Welsh and I served on a number of committees together in the Parliament, and although we were political opponents, he was always a very decent and courteous man with a strong Christian faith, and he will be sadly missed by all in this chamber and everyone who knew him. Presiding Officer, this has been a very short bill process, but I'd like to thank members of the legislation team here in the Parliament for their assistance in relation to the preparation of amendments put forward by my colleagues and myself. With the very tight timescales, there was a great deal of pressure put upon them, having to work late into the night, and we certainly appreciate the extra lengths they had to go to. We set out on Tuesday in the Stage 1 debate our concerns about the pace with which this legislation had been introduced. I do not intend to rehearse all these arguments today, as they are on the record. But I think the manner in which we dealt with amendments yesterday tells its own story. We were trying to deal with significant issues in a very short space of time, and there was very limited opportunity for any detailed parliamentary scrutiny or indeed external input from stakeholders. We nevertheless did our best to engage with the bill and put forward a number of amendments for discussion. I noted at the time Jackie Bailey's attempt to widen the scope of the bill, and although I understand her reasons for doing that, I do not believe that would have been a helpful move when already we were trying to rush through too many measures without sufficient time for scrutiny. Presiding Officer, at the heart of this bill process lies an essential contradiction. On the one hand, we had the First Minister telling this chamber on Tuesday that things were getting better, that restrictions were on track to being eased, and by mid-August we should be back to some degree of normality, all being well. In contrast, we have had the Deputy First Minister saying that extraordinary and unprecedented powers for ministers must be extended for at least another... yes, or can we?
I think the member would agree... Thank you. I think the member would agree, in fairness to the First Minister, that her statements were heavily caveated with the progress of the vaccine programme and also whether we have further mutations of the virus. None of us can ignore that.
Murdo Fraser.
Yes, I accept they were caveated. Indeed, I've already conceded that point, but the powers we're being asked to pass today will extend for at least another 6 months after the end of September, potentially for another 6 months after that. So we're looking at having these measures in place for some 8 months after the point where the First Minister is telling us we should be getting back to normal. And in the worst case scenario, they could be in place for a year and 2 months. And that is quite extraordinary. And this confusion, this lack of consistency, cuts right across the government approach to COVID. And I know from communications from constituents how concerned they are about it. People simply cannot understand why it is they are unable to attend graduation ceremonies for children leaving nursery or stand in a field socially distanced to watch their children's sports day when the Scottish Government has sanctioned 3,000 fans gathering together in the fan zone in Glasgow, where, if our TV screens are to be believed, very little social distancing has been enforced. Similarly, people cannot understand why a travel ban has been introduced for Manchester, when we have seen a very similar case rate in the city of Dundee, but no steps have been taken to restrict travel in and out of that city, when we have the ban affecting Manchester. When we saw some weeks ago large numbers of Rangers fans gathering in George Square to celebrate their club's historic 55th league victory, again with very little sign of social distancing, there was strident condemnation from the First Minister and the Justice Secretary. And they were right to condemn those breaches of the rules. And yet when we see perhaps as many as 30,000 Scotland fans travelling to London last week, again with little sign of social distancing, we've not heard a peep from either of these individuals in condemnation. And what we've seen this week is a spike in the number of COVID cases in Scotland, particularly amongst younger males, which may well be attributable to people gathering to watch the football. And I've certainly been told of at least one busload of Scotland supporters which travelled back at the weekend, where every single person on the bus subsequently tested positive for COVID. What people struggle to understand is why there should be one rule for one and another rule for others. And it's this lack of consistency and clear messaging that is undermining confidence in the public health communications. Presiding Officer, we even saw confusion during the passage of this bill, and we discussed this point earlier, because my colleague Graeme Simpson brought forward an amendment yesterday seeking to remove the restriction on the public attending meetings of licensing boards after the 30th of September. A parallel amendment was brought forward by Alex Cole-Hamilton to do the same for local council meetings. Now, yesterday, the Deputy First Minister accepted Mr Cole-Hamilton's amendment, but rejected Mr Simpson's. This was utterly illogical. There was no basis for taking a different view on licensing board meetings as against local council meetings. Again, a lack of consistency and confusion. And although the matter was cleared up this afternoon and rectified when the government agreed to support Mr Simpson bringing back his amendment, I think this small episode just illustrates my point for me about the rushed nature in which this bill has been brought forward, with little time for consultation and not enough time for scrutiny or detailed consideration. Presiding officer, I set out on Tuesday why we cannot support this bill as it stands, and our position has not changed. While there are some measures here we will support, there are others with which we have serious concerns about. But overall, these measures should not have been railroaded through Parliament in the course of 3 days without detailed scrutiny and consultation. There was ample time to have this matter considered in September, when we would be much clearer about the COVID situation in the autumn. And for all these reasons, we will maintain our opposition to this bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. I now call on Jackie Bailey. Ms Bailey, 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I associate the Scottish Labour Party with the remarks made by the Deputy First Minister about the sad death of Andrew Welsh and offer condolences to his family? I always recall Andrew as being a very gentlemanly person, always very kind, but nevertheless quite determined. As a former chief whip for the SNP, I suspect he would have been in pursuit of Bill Kidd as we speak to have his card marked. But there we go. Presiding officer, we've reached the stage three debate at breakneck speed, having only started stage one 2 days ago on Tuesday. I want to therefore record my thanks to the Parliament, the legislation team in particular, for the drafting of amendments at incredibly short notice. The Cabinet Secretary, who was occasionally there, his civil servants, and in particular his special adviser, with whom I was negotiating with last night and this morning. And of course the Scottish Labour team, who have worked hard to improve this legislation. For many colleagues across the chamber, this is the first legislation they have engaged with in this Parliament, and boy oh boy did they make an impression. And like me, I hope that they think the effort overall has been worth it. So changes to reporting on live music, pubs and weddings, pursued by Pauline McNeill. Changes to reporting on social care and the effect that the extension of the Act will have on social care, and indeed the need to restore care packages and respite to pre-pandemic levels, pursued by Pam Duncan-Glancy with a little help from Bill Kidd. Changes to monitoring and reporting, changes to providing information to the Parliament in advance of decisions being made. All of those helping to improve the legislation. And aside from the specifics of the bill, we genuinely cannot return to Parliament debating and voting on issues weeks after they have been decided. If the UK government and Parliament can ensure that there is scrutiny and members can vote on changes within days, then there is no reason that this Parliament can't do likewise. And this will help with the issue of consistency raised by Murdo Fraser, because there is real concern that if there is no logic to the decisions and no consistency, that compliance will diminish as a consequence. I still remain to be convinced that we need emergency legislation in place beyond April 2022. There does appear to be more hope that containing the virus in the future due to the rollout of the vaccination programme is there. I understand that case numbers are going up, but unsurprisingly, this is amongst younger men. Some have noted that this causal effect may be because of the association with football and the Euros. Secondly, Parliament is sitting, its committees are constituted, and as we have demonstrated this week, we can deal with emergency legislation quickly. I would therefore caution the government about extending emergency legislation any longer than necessary. The Cabinet Secretary knows that I believe that the bill has been too tightly drafted, preventing members from adding in areas of policy where they feel there is a gap. We have nevertheless found creative ways, at least about having the debate and placing reporting requirements on ministers, so those issues are still in the spotlight. Nowhere is this more clear than in the debate about evictions and continuing the ban for all levels of restrictions due to COVID. Let me make clear again that the only area of concern is with housing arrears that have arisen for tenants due to COVID. If a tenant is responsible for antisocial behaviour or criminality, that should not be included in a ban on evictions. Our concern stems from the fact that the economic impact of the pandemic has still not been fully experienced. Some people have lost their jobs at the very start. Others are back at work but underemployed. Others, again, are still on furlough and might not have a job to go to when the scheme finishes. So there are considerable financial uncertainties ahead. We know that eviction orders are currently appearing in sheriff courts across Scotland and people are in danger of losing the roof over their heads. If it is for COVID-related reasons, we really should not allow this to happen. I therefore welcome the new Tenant Hardship Grant Fund. The Cabinet Secretary has acknowledged that the previous loan fund simply did not work, and Scottish Labour have been raising this for some time, and I am very glad that he has listened. I did, however, ask him about converting loans into grants, about deferring payments to avoid getting people into more debt. I'm not sure I got a response, so I'm trying again, and I would welcome any response he could offer, together with information on when the fund will be open, who is eligible, how they apply for it, and when the funding will be dispensed, because there isn't a moment to lose. Finally, Presiding Officer, I said at the start of stage one that we've lived through an extraordinary 15 months. No one could have anticipated the length or depth of the pandemic or the tragic loss of life for far too many people. Emergency legislation was required to cope with the scale of the response we needed. But the key message, I think, for the government is that in exercising those powers, the Scottish Government must understand that it should cooperate with the scrutiny required of it by this Parliament. Scottish Labour will support the bill at stage three.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call on Ariane Burgess. Ms Burgess, 4 minutes, please.
I'd like to thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to associate the Scottish Green Party with the Deputy First Minister's comments on Andrew Welsh. He sounds like someone I would have liked to have met and worked with. I'd like to put on record the thanks of my party colleagues and I to the wonderful team of clerks and the wider Parliament staff who have worked hard to make the process of this emergency bill as smooth as possible, particularly in such a short time frame. For us newbies, this emergency legislation process has been a frantic and fascinating learning opportunity. Unfortunately, this legislation is still necessary. The pandemic is not over. New cases continue to rise. We heard that some may wish to simply see how COVID develops over the summer, but if the past 18 months has taught us anything, that is simply short-sighted. There can be no doubt that the vaccination programme is our best route out of this pandemic, but we would be failing the people of Scotland if we chose not to prepare. We should hope for the best and plan for the worst. That means maintaining both the public health measures and the social protections that people need. At stage one, my colleague Lorna Slater set out our disappointment that this bill did not provide greater protections for tenants, many of whom are still facing the threat of looming redundancy as the furlough scheme ends. We also regret that it was not possible to extend the eviction ban to all until the coronavirus restrictions are lifted. I welcome the provision agreed into the bill to report on the status of eviction provisions. This will provide valuable data for the Chamber to see the extent of the problem. But Scotland lags behind much of Europe in how we protect those who rent their homes. And I hope that this Chamber will get the opportunity to properly tackle the deep-set problems faced by those who rent their homes. The Scottish Greens are pleased to see Amendment 3 included in the bill, as we believe it balances the need for transparency and accountability with the need for the Care Inspectorate to directly support care providers. It recognises that while it is not currently necessary for the Care Inspectorate to report to Parliament, circumstances may change, and if a new, more dangerous strain was to enter the country, it may be required months more. I'm glad that the concerns expressed by Scottish Care were listened to, and I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey and the Deputy First Minister for taking on board my colleague Gillian Mackay's suggestion. Next, and perhaps more importantly, there's the need to look forward. The government has already indicated that some aspects of the changes which came in as a response to COVID will have longer-term value and will be made permanent. They have already said that there will be a permanence bill to do this, but that will be a long-term piece of work. Some of that might be uncontroversial, like measures to make online and remote working more routine. But other aspects will be contested, from protecting tenants' rights to protecting people from exploitative working conditions and precarious incomes. There will be questions of economic justice where parties will have different views. We should not shy away from that debate. This should be seen as a historic opportunity to reshape the economy in fair, ethical, and sustainable ways. We must take care not to pursue a shallow understanding of recovery and race back to business as usual with a sole focus on anything that increases GDP, regardless of the social and environmental consequences. Presiding Officer, nobody likes the fact that emergency legislation has been needed, and nobody should pretend that the process is ideal. In fact, it's far from ideal, as we've heard from my colleagues already. But it is necessary to ensure that we put the right protections in place for the people of Scotland in the coming months. The Scottish Green Party will support the bill.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton. Mr Cole-Hamilton, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by offering the condolences of the Liberal Democrats, everyone who knew Andrew Welsh, a fine figure of a man. Can I also thank the work that's gone into this bill for the legislation and clerking teams. This has been no small feat, and they have our thanks. But I rise on behalf of the Liberal Democrats to explain why, after careful consideration, Deputy Presiding Officer, we will not be supporting this bill at decision time tonight. Not because we don't think we need some kind of legislation, we do, but we just want to see a better bill, a more considered bill, and one that does not extend power to this extent or for this length of time. The Coronavirus Acts are ones that, as Liberals, we have always been instinctively uncomfortable with, because despite the security they have offered some groups within our society and the protections they have sought to give the most vulnerable, this bill offers powers to the government for far longer than we believe that they will require. It gives this government unprecedented rights to introduce legislation without the level of scrutiny that we should expect in any healthy democracy. And thanks to the vaccines, Deputy Presiding Officer, this nation is far healthier than it was when these acts were first passed. And as I said yesterday, the fundamental principles of this bill is that it creates emergency powers that should exist in the context of an emergency. We are not persuaded in my party that this trajectory, the trajectory of this emergency in which we find ourselves, will last for the length of time that the legislation might empower ministers for. Put simply, Presiding Officer, Liberal Democrats do not believe it was necessary to bring forward such a bill in such short order for one that lasts so long. The government's answer to concerns over the duration of the powers extended in this bill, as voiced by my party and by the Conservatives and others, is the threat of new variants. But, Presiding Officer, the threat of new variants is a threat that may never expire. That threat may evade the vaccine. Variants may evade the vaccine, but just as real for the next decade as they are next week. Put simply, throughout this pandemic, ministers have shown that they are willing to and are able to legislate quickly. If the government can find time to push through a bill as important as this one in just 3 days, then they, at any time, should the vaccines fail us, can bring forward new legislation that we can pass just as quickly. And the government has stretched, and I believe at times broken with, the tolerance and good faith of members when it comes to making announcements to this Parliament. So I'm very grateful for the agreement reached with Jackie Bailey from the Deputy First Minister's office on the future conduct of such announcements. This was a difficult decision for the Liberal Democrats. We don't have a cavalier attitude towards this virus or our route out of it, but we also value the importance of scrutiny and parliamentary democracy. And the bill as it stands is an overreach of ministerial power that we just could not countenance. It is not a considered piece of legislation. We have just had 2 hours, barely more, to look at the amendments for this bill, and it has so much potential to give the government so much power for so long. We don't suggest that there should be nothing. I should say that. That the powers and protections of the original Act should just fall away. We're saying nothing like that. Instead, we appeal to the government to use the summer to bring to Parliament, after our return, a better bill, one that is informed by the landscape of the virus as we find it in the late summer, one which safeguards the supremacy of this chamber and that shortens to the bare minimum the amount of time that ministers have to exercise those powers, because we do need something. There are protections in this bill that Liberal Democrats really support, particularly around the protection it affords tenants for eviction and other rights to renters. We want to continue these, and this should form the central precept of any future bill. A new bill would also need to disapply the extension to time limits on criminal proceedings, because, as I've said before, that is delaying criminal justice and leading to increase of the population on remand. This is an important piece of legislation. Of that, there is no doubt. But it is because of that importance that we ask this government to think again. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. We now move to the brief open debate. And firstly, I call Christine Graham, who will be followed by James.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. With your leave, can I add my comments about colleague and 99er Andrew Welsh, a serious politician, a gentle politician, but with a fun side. You didn't know he could play all the Buddy Holly playlist faultlessly on his guitar. I think that's a tribute. Now, to the policy memorandum of this bill. This updates a range of existing legislation measures which support various aspects of coronavirus regulation. This was all going to fall at the end of September. That's my understanding. So now we've got something that's to take its place. Not something to introduce new measures, but to take place and to allow those regulations that we don't need anymore to fall and those that need to be extended to be extended. So it's not introducing anything new, and I'll come to Mr. Sweeney in a minute, though I commend Ms. Duncan Glancy on her persistence. I'll come to her as well. So the question is, in broad terms, is this legislation proportionate to the challenge, and are the regulations continuing, lasting only as long as is necessary? And I have to say, I believe so. Now, I sat through this yesterday's amendments, and I sat through today's, and I want to commend Graham Simpson, lovely man Graham Simpson, that's who finished, and for persisting on what was really the right thing to do, that licensing committees should be sitting in public if councils and housing was going to sit in public. And I think it's good when the front bench sees that there's something amiss and immediately remedies it, and that should be subject to applause rather than condemnation. To Jackie Bailey again, well, I don't know where she's gone. Jackie Bailey, similarly in care homes, I always think she's formidable, she remains formidable, and she's got the right result. On reporting to Parliament, I was interested to see the list. This is not a prop, you know, that Deputy Presiding Officer is not happy with props, but this is the list of the omnibus reporting. I think that was the right way to go about it. And again, I commend Pauline McNeill on persisting with live music. I have great sympathy for her. We've all got events in our constituency. So reporting on the progress to allowing live music, whether it's pipe bands, silver bands, discos, whatever your taste is, that's, again, a good move. And she's good at pursuing it. I like her style. Mr. Sweeney, I think we'll tangle again on occasion. I'm looking forward to it. It was a very strange amendment, but you gave me a wonderful opportunity to pat on the back my local bus service, which I'm going to do again. Doesn't mean I get free transport because I've got a concessionary bus pass anyway. Borders buses have done a whole lot. They're a family-run business. This is important. They're not a big commercial company. They're a family-run business from their third generation. What a difference they've made to First Bus East, who were there before, who were rubbish. They have brought in new fleet. They have delivered. I see you would agree with Ms. Hamilton. They have brought in an app to help people. They've given free transport to care workers and health workers. So I won't have a word said against them unless they deserve it, and they don't deserve it. Pamela Duncan Glancy, third time lucky. Well, poor, poor Bill. What can one say except, thank goodness he's got recess coming up. I noticed that our chief whip's back. Believe you me, you don't tangle with George Adam lightly. So his card is marked very heavily. Poor Bill, I hope you'll be listening. I'll help you out, Bill. I'm used to taking on the whips. Now, in conclusion, Emergencies will continue. I've not got the same... I'm a bit of a pessimist in this, because every time I think we're getting through something, there's another variant. So I really don't have concerns about extending this for 6 months to March. Besides, you see, there's always a possibility that if we really do get through this, we take our vaccines run ahead of any variants and we're able to live with it, any legislation can be repealed. But I don't want to see us having legislation that is short-term and then having to come back and extend it. Everything we see so far is not brilliant news about variants that's happening. So that's why I think this legislation is necessary, and I thank you for your support, which I hope to get.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I will not reprimand you for referring to Bill Kidd by his first name, as it was clearly an attempt to protect his anonymity. I now call on Jamie Green, who will be followed by Paul Sweeney. Mr Green, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a far more interesting afternoon than I expected it to be, I think. Can I thank the legislation team for all their help, and my own parliamentary team for slogging it for the past couple of days. I don't really want to rerun all of the arguments of the debate, because I think, as Murdo Fraser put it, all of that is already on the record. I think it's fair to say, though, that concerns were raised right across the chamber over the last few days, not just on the nature of emergency powers that we're extending, but the entire process through which they are being extended. And that didn't just come from these benches, it came from all over. Labour probed the government rightly on a number of issues, on wedding restrictions, live music, as we heard a lot of today, but also on more sombre issues, the emergency powers that the government wishes to extend, the effect they're having on disabled people, for example, and right to probe those issues. The Liberal Democrats sought to allow the public to participate more fully in local council meetings, and Graham Simpson tried to do the same with alcohol licensing boards. On one, the government conceded yesterday, but on the other, curiously, it did not. Of course, it's always good to see Mr. Sweeney see sense. I know he always does in the end, and today we saw that rightly so. Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. But the Greens, too, participated in this debate this week by expressing concern about the Care Inspectorate's ability to carry out its functions and provide care services during the pandemic, all addressed at stage three. And I, of course, tried in earnest to raise awareness of some very live issues raised by stakeholders, those who had the very limited opportunity to engage with us as lawmakers. I tried to remove provisions in the powers which would allow ministers to grant prisoners early release and write off community orders, both of which I believe are completely unnecessary in the current climate. Of course, the only apparent success yesterday was the amendment on hearsay evidence, something which I think the whole chamber felt strongly about. It was a sensible issue and a sensible outcome. But in my view, it wasn't the only sensible issue which merited success, because clearly the blunt instrument that was available to us was simply to either revoke or expire powers within the bill. And I understand why that was unpalatable to many members. I don't blame them, because this whole process was far from ideal. What we wanted to do instead was meaningfully add to the bill. We could have added sunset clauses. We could have added additional checks and balances. We could have made these extensions further subject to further enhanced legislative scrutiny, either by the Parliament or indeed by our committees, which is the whole point of them. And all of those would have helped curb what I think in our eyes was an unnecessary and overtly long extension of what initially, remember, were emergency powers. Emergency powers granted in the time of an emergency. These are complex policy issues, and we debated them in just a few short hours with little or no consultation. The Stage 2 debate yesterday threw open a whole Pandora's box on a range of these complex issues. And I don't buy the argument, I'm afraid, that we would not have been able to achieve royal assent on this bill had we passed Stage 3 in September after robust consultation right throughout the summer. Look, I know this is not the most contentious of bills in the world, nor are all the powers that the government are seeking the most contentious. But that's not the point, because the next bill might be. And I think that's what worries me the most, the precedent that we've set this week by rushing bills through Parliament. And just because there might be a political majority either on the Bureau or in the Chamber through the process of simple majority, that doesn't make it right. There must be checks and balances on all of this. It raises a conundrum for us all, Presiding Officer, and it's a process one, not a political one. Who decides what constitutes an emergency, and how is that decided? And what is this Parliament's last defence to stopping us making errors of judgment. Our legislation must be watertight, and it must be subject to the highest, the very highest levels of scrutiny wherever possible. That should never be compromised, in my view, because we all have a duty to respect and protect the robustness of our lawmaking. And that's why so many of us are irked this week. Let me say in closing, rushed law is never good law. And I'm afraid history vindicates that. So regretfully, I too will oppose this bill at decision time.
Thank you, Mr. Green. And we now move to Paul Sweeney, after which we will move to the closing speeches. Mr. Sweeney, about 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's certainly been a brief but intense apprenticeship in the ways of legislating in the Scottish Parliament, but one that's been certainly interesting and enlightening. And although the Labour Party will support the bill because it's essential to the functioning of the country in this crisis, I think there's important lessons that we can take away from today's and this week's, indeed, proceedings. That placing such an intense burden on the parliamentarians hasn't been an effective way to legislate, and I think given the amount of time that we had available to us over this month, indeed, we could have spent much more time deliberating this and indeed expanding the scope of the Act, what will I'm sure become the Act, to allow for greater scope for delivering better policy outcomes for Scotland. And I think that's what we all would share a common objective on. And I think it's been great that given the constraints, we've been able to work so effectively together, in large part, though not in my amendments case, to achieve meaningful changes. And I think that's been a worthwhile exercise. Whether it was Jackie Bailey's efforts to improve scrutiny and government reporting to this Parliament to show the respect it deserves, I think is worthwhile. Whether it's Pauline McNeill's efforts with regards to improving our efforts to look at supporting sectors that have been overlooked, particularly hospitality and entertainment venues. Whether it was, of course, Pam's rather unexpected breakthrough with regards to social care reporting, which has been a worthwhile exercise. Maybe the government could learn that actually accepting opposition amendments is not such a bad thing. Maybe it's a worthwhile thing to have brought forward and achieved in the face of the bill. I know there has been certain controversy about my proposals, and I think I was wanting to test this effort because it's actually something that's not going to go away. This is something we are going to have to get to grips with sooner or later. And I think this has pointed to a number of policy issues that we need to rise to the challenge on. Whenever this country has been confronted with a crisis, it's been used as a great opportunity to reform and massively improve public policy. And we need to rise to a similar challenge going forward into the autumn. I would hope that the Cabinet Secretary will take cognizance of that point and hopefully speak to it in his closing remarks. The evictions time bomb is just one example. This isn't going to go away. The arrears that people are facing, the pressure that housing associations and other landlords are facing isn't going to go away, and we will have to have a point of correction as a country. I would like to see us move to a more socialised system of tenure, an extension of state support for those who are facing arrears. I think we expressed those desires in our proposed amendments. And I think the space should be given by the government to consider that in more detail and with more patience. Similarly, there are other public policy improvements that we can achieve. This Parliament has already agreed, as I made clear, that we believe in greater coordination, integration and regulation of public transportation in this country if we are to meet our climate emergency objectives and indeed just to improve our society. And that was really what I was trying to probe in this proposed amendment, which was sadly unsuccessful. And I feel there's a bit of non-secuteurs floating around the chamber about, you know, hammering family-owned bus companies. I must say, I have no quarrel with that bus company. I have a quarrel with First Glasgow primarily, who are an atrocious operator, and I'll put it on record that they are, failing the people of Glasgow and have for years. And I don't want to see the spectacle of ministers going to that company and begging them to keep routes going when there are sufficient provisions in legislation to effect the change. That is not what we send MSPs to this Parliament to do, and it's not what we elect the government to do. We elect them to govern, not beg private companies for mercy, to deliver a basic public service, and we need to rise to the challenge on that front. Similarly, with the Fair Work agenda, I know Mr. McMillan made an interesting point. I wasn't quite sure I followed the logic of it, but about Texas Instruments as being one example of a company that might have been somehow stymied by trade union organisation in the efforts to save that plant from closure. If anything, I think the examples we just heard at First Minister's questions and indeed previous campaigns such as the Calais and Springburn, that trade unions were essential to ensuring the effort was at least put in to saving those facilities, those plants, those jobs, those skills, the lifeblood of the Scottish economy. Trade unions are not an enemy of enterprise. The state should be more entrepreneurial, and we need to work together in a spirit of collaboration to achieve better public policy outcomes for Scotland. And I hope that although this bill might not be giving it the scope it needs, it's not going to go away, and we need to create the space in the autumn to discuss it in more detail.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. We now move to the closing speeches, and I call on Gillian Mackay. Around 4 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak in today's debate. Scotland currently has the highest rate among all of the UK nations, and yesterday we recorded the highest daily number of cases since the start of mass testing. Despite the incredible success of the vaccination programme and the very welcome lifting of restrictions, it is clear that the pandemic is not over and that, unfortunately, emergency legislation is still very much needed. According to the latest data, only a quarter of those aged 30 to 39 have received both doses of the vaccine, and less than a fifth of those aged 18 to 29. Our young people are still vulnerable, and there is significant evidence that people in those age groups are now driving infection. The Delta variant is moderately resistant to vaccines, particularly in people who've received a single dose, and people infected with Delta are about twice as likely to end up in hospital compared to those infected with the Alpha strain. We need to continue to support people to isolate when they're infected and encourage them to engage in regular testing. We are not out of the woods yet. I'm pleased to see Jackie Bailey's amendment agreed to, and I hope it addresses the concerns of those in the care home sector. As we all know, the pandemic has been an extremely difficult time for care services, and it's vital they have the support they need to recover from COVID-19. Given the Care Inspectorate has responsibilities for regulation and inspection of care services, they will play a vital role in supporting care homes to deliver the best standard of care possible. Like others in the Chamber, I regret that the scope of this bill could not be widened, so that we could assist those who will undoubtedly be affected by the ongoing pandemic, but who are not protected by the provisions currently contained within the coronavirus legislation. I agree wholeheartedly with Pam Duncan-Glancy's comments yesterday that a provision which instructed local authorities to recommence care packages and respite care would have been a welcome inclusion in the bill. In addition, the Scottish Greens have long called for self-isolation payments to be made universal so that everyone is supported to isolate and no one is forced to choose between isolating and paying their bills. I note that Pam Duncan-Glancy mentioned yesterday her desire to include this provision in the bill, and I'm pleased to see Labour's support for this. I look forward to continuing to engage with parliamentary colleagues and the Scottish Government regarding these issues after the bill has passed. There are some provisions within the coronavirus bills which I would like to see continue after the pandemic has ended. For example, those provisions which relate to student residential tenancies and the restriction on giving grants to businesses connected to tax havens. Students now have the same rights as other tenants, and this should continue after the legislation expires. Likewise, ensuring there were no coronavirus bailouts for firms that used tax havens was a welcome step during the pandemic, but I believe we should push further on this issue and ending legal tax avoidance permanently. To conclude, Presiding Officer, before I completely lose my voice, although I know all of us in the Chamber would prefer that emergency legislation was not necessary, the state of the pandemic in Scotland today necessitates that this bill is passed. I'm grateful to all those members who've engaged with the Scottish Greens during this process, and I look forward to continuing to work to ensure that the people of Scotland are protected from the effects of this terrible virus. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. And I call on Mark Griffin. Mr Griffin, you have, again, four minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interests as an owner of a rental property in North Lanarkshire. For those of us who have been involved in the various stages of this legislation, it's been a fairly hectic week, and it's highlighted why emergency legislation procedures should be used sparingly. Being in the midst of a global pandemic is obviously solid reasoning for using that process, but it hasn't been without its difficulty. There's no formal government or committee consultation and scrutiny, little more than 12 hours after Stage 1 and Stage 2 to consider, discuss and lodge amendments, and it stifles that opportunity for meaningful discussion between backbench MSPs and ministers. The drafting of the legislation in such a narrow way has also limited the way members could amend the bill to best reflect how we feel we should respond to the pandemic, and in my mind that's no clearer than when we are talking about protection of tenancies. I'm starting to feel like a bit of a broken record, having basically said the same thing in the chamber for 3 days in a row now, but it does bear repeating, Presiding Officer. The ability to isolate at home is the most important response we have to breaking the transmission of COVID-19. Vaccines are obviously a huge part too, but the evidence on impact on transmissibility isn't yet clear. The most effective way to avoid passing the disease to another person is isolating at home. And to do that, you clearly need to have a home. On the same basis as the government's arguments that furlough and the £20 uplift in universal credit should be extended, which I support, the ban on evictions should have been extended to level 1 and 2 areas, and the fact there is no provision or ability to amend to reflect that is a failing of this piece of legislation. The government have made the case to the UK government on furlough and universal credit because we're still living with restrictions, because entire sections of the economy are still severely impacted or not functioning at all. Surely Scottish ministers must accept that the same arguments apply to the extension of the eviction ban. Many households have been affected by unemployment, reduced employment, reduced earnings, or surviving on furlough. Lots of people have accumulated debts and rent arrears through no fault of their own because of a global pandemic. The response from government to that should be a combined effort to halt evictions and to deal with the source of the problem, those arrears built up as a result of the pandemic. The government have announced a new grant fund to tackle arrears. That is very welcome, but we desperately need to see the qualifying criteria, a stronger commitment to convert any loans from the current scheme to grants, and an assessment of whether the £10 million mentioned will be sufficient to halt the predicted tidal wave of eviction notices from organisations in the housing sector. Presiding Officer, we will be supporting the legislation at decision time, but we are looking for those concrete commitments from government that the issue of entitlement and adequacy of the grant fund, and that the volume of eviction proceedings will be closely monitored and urgent action taken to protect tenants if required. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Griffin. I now call on Miles Briggs. Mr Briggs, around 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Parliament's legislation team for the power of work which they have put in over the course of this week. As Mark Griffin stated, this is not how the Scottish Parliament should function. MSPs should have the full opportunity to consult and properly consider and amend bills. Indeed, Mr Sweeney should have had the same right as Mr Swinney to influence this legislation. This week has just gone to demonstrate the key point which Scottish Conservatives have made throughout the stages of this bill, that rushed legislation can often be bad legislation. What this bill does today is leave Scotland in a landing pattern. These unprecedented powers will remain in SNP ministers' hands for at least another 6 months until the end of September, and potentially for another 6 months beyond that into 2022. Deputy Presiding Officer, it is critical that we see the Scottish Government and this Parliament focus 100% on the economic recovery from this pandemic. Small businesses across the country are crying out for help. Yesterday, we saw employees from the travel and tourism sector demonstrate outside Parliament. And more recently, the soft play businesses and their staff were also forced to protest outside Parliament. This bill will continue to give ministers the powers to further restrict and keep these businesses closed and potentially shut them again at any point in the future. Deputy Presiding Officer, the soft play sector in Scotland feel totally abandoned by SNP ministers. These popular local businesses have been legally unable to open for over 470 days, some 15 months, while soft play centres across the rest of the UK have operated safely between lockdowns and with no negative impact on public health. The soft play sector, with the same public demographic and material environment, cannot understand why they have not been selected, by the Scottish Government for such severe closure restrictions and a total lack of financial support. At the same time as trampoline parks, play cafes, play groups and other children indoor activities have not been open for months. As Pauline McNeill stated, many businesses have asked for but never been provided with the evidence SNP ministers state inform their decision making. As one soft play operator said to me, there is no data to support the Scottish Government action against soft play. No data to warrant... I will if I get the time back. Yeah.
Christine Graham.
I'm not sure where Mr Briggs attended the briefing from Jason Leach for all MSPs where he dealt with soft play areas. Were you at that meeting?
Miles Briggs.
I'm not sure which meeting you're talking about for the last...
It was...
Mr Briggs, carry on.
Throughout the pandemic, I've been engaging with the soft play sector, and this is the quotes I'm reading out are specifically from them. And this is why they have said that they need to see support from the government. They need to get access to the data as well. And they're desperately seeking this action from ministers, as they have throughout the pandemic. As one soft play operator who I mentioned before the protest outside wrote to me, saying, unfortunately, our numbers are considerably diminished from our first time protesting outside Parliament in September 2020. This is mainly due to a number of their peers whose businesses have been destroyed by the Scottish Government experiment on our industry, and the others whose mental health is so awful now that they freely admit they do not have any fight left in them. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is a minority government. However, ministers have acted this week like they have a majority railroading this bill through Parliament. The economic pain from the pandemic is still truly to be realised, Deputy First Minister. And what is increasingly concerning is that the First Minister and SNP ministers' decisions could lead to further economic pain and job losses in Scotland. Perhaps after the summer recess, we will see an SNP Green coalition announced. Although from what I read in today's newspapers, I'm not sure if the Deputy First Minister is part of the SNP's right wing, the Green members seem so concerned about working with. But Scottish Conservatives have tried to engage constructively with ministers throughout this process and see if the Scottish Government and Deputy First Minister would see the errors of their ways. Perhaps after this afternoon, the Deputy First Minister may wish he had listened. But as the Deputy First Minister said early in this week, you can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make it drink. Scottish Conservatives will oppose this bill at decision time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. I now call on the Deputy First Minister to wind up the debate. You've got around 6 minutes, Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin, first of all, by expressing my warmest thanks to the Parliament's legislation team, who I know have had to work extremely hard in difficult circumstances this week, to the Bill team, who've supported me splendidly in putting this legislation together, and to the special advisor who supported me throughout this process, whose contact book has appalled me during this whole process, but thankfully it's been of great assistance. About the only comment that Jamie Green said this afternoon I agreed with was that this afternoon had been more entertaining than expected, I really wish Polly McNeill was here for this moment, because she introduced the concept of cringe dancing to the debate yesterday, and then this afternoon Christine Graham tried, as only I could expect Christine Graham to do, to crowbar the concept of discos into the live music venues, and even I feel sufficiently close enough to the real life that I'm not altogether sure discos are what they're called nowadays, Christine. Ms Graham, I should say, excuse me, Presiding Officer, there's a momentary lapse there, so it's. But we'll get some up-to-date advice on that from Polly McNeill. If it's on Mr Kerr's contribution to cringe dancing, then yes, I will give way.
Mr Kerr.
I'm afraid I can't deliver on that particular comment, the Deputy First Minister's office. But first of all, can I just associate myself with everything that the Deputy First Minister said about Andrew Welsh? He was my MP, and he was a very good MP, even though we disagreed politically. And I think his words of tribute were wholly appropriate. But can I ask the First Minister about Christine Graham's contribution, which I thoroughly enjoyed as well. Does he agree with Christine Graham that at some point in the lifetime of this Act, as it will become, the powers are no longer appropriate? Does he agree with her that that this Act should be repealed as soon as possible?
Deputy First Minister.
No, I don't, because I wouldn't bring the bill forward if I thought that. But obviously, if the powers are not to be utilised, then, for example, the government would not enact an extension from after the initial six-month period if we judged it not to be required, because we would carry out that evaluation. I think there was a... Murdo Fraser had the brass neck to attack consistency of arguments within the government. There was a lack of consistency on the Conservative benches, because Mr Simpson was entirely gracious about my support for his licensing amendment today when I didn't get a word of thanks from Murdo Fraser in the process. So I do encourage the Conservatives to get consistent on this. It is injured pride, Mr Fraser. You are, in that respect, absolutely correct. To move on to the substance of the debate, Ariane Burgess made a number of comments about the limited scope of the bill and the fact that there is a debate to be had about what is the nature and the character of our recovery from COVID. And indeed, Mr Sweeney, in his latter contribution to the debate, made the point about how out of most moments of crisis there is a substantial reform of public policy. And I agree with that. And there has to be a substantial reform of public policy to make sure that many of the legitimate issues that he was raising, I thought somewhat, perhaps he wasn't using the right vehicle to advance the arguments today. Vehicles have been very much the subject of debate in the debate today. He will be able to get on a Borders bus with a clear conscience from now on after his gallant response to Christine Graham. But there is a point of substance that we have to engage as a parliament about the route to recovery, and that's very much what I look forward to doing in the COVID Recovery Committee, which will be chaired by Siobhan Brown, and which brings representation from parliament together. So we must ensure that we have that substantive debate about how we recover from COVID, and it's beyond what I would consider to be the operational provisions of this bill, which have not charted new ground. They have simply been an extension of the provisions that Parliament has already legislated for. And although that has attracted some criticism, I think it was the right judgment for the government to make. Mr Griffin and Jackie Bailey both raised issues about the Tenant Hardship Fund, and I indicated yesterday that this will be launched later on in the year. We will consult extensively with stakeholders in the establishment of the details, the criteria, and also on the question of conversion of any loans. But I do also want to put on the record the good work that has been done by a whole range of different stakeholders, registered social landlords, local authorities, the housing association movement, in collaboration with the government on trying to avoid evictions in the first place. And although it is right for us to focus on the Tenant Hardship Fund, it's also right for me to put on the record the really good work that many stakeholders have undertaken to make sure that we support tenants through difficult times, given the fact that the coronavirus is disrupting the economy, it's disrupting livelihoods, and it may, as a consequence, disrupt tenancies, and we must try to avoid that being the case for individuals, because they deserve our support. And can I thank members for their forbearance over the last 3 days? I do want to scotch the rumour that this was actually an early continuous professional development exercise for new members of Parliament to be given a crash course in legislation over a 3-day period. That was not my intention, but I do thank members of Parliament, and indeed members who have just joined Parliament, for the way in which they have engaged in the process to enhance the legislation, to advance issues that were of importance to members, and to ensure that we have the correct statutory framework in place to deal with what is a continuing, ongoing threat that we face from coronavirus. We hope that we are moving into more optimistic times in relation to the management of the virus due to the success of the vaccination programme. But the data that we are experiencing this week demonstrates that this problem has not deserted us in any shape or form. So having this legislation in place, which I do assure the Conservatives will not be maintained for a moment longer than we think it is required, and we will faithfully engage in the reporting arrangements and accountability arrangements that Parliament has strengthened today. We followed them all since the legislation was put in place last spring. We will continue to do so, but obviously covering some new ground as a consequence of the amendments that have been advanced today. And I look forward to the midnight oil being burnt in producing the reports that will satisfy the requirements of statute. And I would encourage Parliament to support the bill at decision time.
Thank you. That concludes this point of order. Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today, the Scottish Government were forced through a Freedom of Information request to release the draft publication of the Food and Farming Future Farm Policy Group recommendations, which they did so on the final day of Parliament before recess. It's now been 2.5 years that we've been waiting for this document, and it's still only in draft format. This document was promised by the Cabinet Secretary in August 2020 after pressure from colleagues, but of course it still was not published. Presiding Officer, the SNP have failed to offer policy clarity in a timely manner to the agricultural industry, and by withholding this promised document for so long, the Scottish Government is disrespecting this Parliament and disrespecting this sector. Can I seek guidance from you, Presiding Officer, as to whether the Scottish Government should uphold their commitment to publish a document when they say they're going to publish it, and ask what parliamentary procedures are in place to ensure that we have time to scrutinise such publications, given that we are heading into recess in a few minutes?
Thank you. I thank the member for advance notice, but it is not a matter for me to rule on. As the member knows, there are several avenues through which members can hold the Scottish Government to account, including during any periods when Parliament is in recess. If the member feels that a government minister has failed in their duty somehow, then she may wish to make a complaint under the relevant article of the Ministerial Code. Point of order, Jamie Green.
But at risk of prolonging the agony, we all are keen for recess to start. But I think the point that we're making, and it's not the only report that came out, another government-initiated question today was around Dame Eilish Angelini's well-respected report into policing. These are quite important matters for the Parliament to look at. However, the problem is the timing of them, signing off. So this one was issued at 2 p.m. this afternoon. It was an hour after First Minister's questions. There's no opportunity for me or anyone to submit urgent or topical questions on the matter, or indeed to question the Cabinet Secretary to whom this topic is related. The question really is whether or not, despite overt requests from the Chair to the Government to make these announcements in a timely fashion, to allow scrutiny from right across the spectrum, whether we will be afforded that respectful opportunity to grill the Government on these matters. And I think that is the point of orders that we're trying to make throughout this.
I thank Mr Green for his point of order. Again, it is not a matter for me to rule on. His comments have been noted, however. Thank you. I call Mercedes Villalba for a point of order.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I realise it's not possible to amend previous votes, but I would like to put it on the record that for Amendment 11, my intention was to support, not oppose.
Thank you, Ms Villalba. Your comments have been noted. Now, where were we? We have concluded. I am pleased to note that we have concluded the Stage 3 debate on Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body Motion 505 on appointments to the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. And I ask Maggie Chapman, on behalf of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am aware that people are keen to get out of this place, so I will just move formally.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 492 on designation of lead committee. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and formally moved.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite a member of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motion.
Once again, Presiding Officer, formally moved.
Thank you very much, Minister. The question is that decision time to be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 479 in the name of John Swinney. The question is that motion 479 in the name of John Swinney on Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we agreed? We will have a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.